Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment. You can listen to The Mike O'Mara Show at MikeO'MaraShow.com.
Let's get started.
It's The Mike O'Mara Show with Mike O'Mara, Oscar Santana, and Rob Spiewak. Now, here's Mike.
So, I was really pleased with yesterday's show. We had a lot of fun. A couple of new voices, lots of good stuff, from both of you guys, and was actually enjoying it. But what we never mentioned during the show, maybe at the very end, I don't remember. It happened right after the show. Apparently, over the last maybe two or three days, following along with the incredible detail, sweating technical aspects of this show, I had been using through the Zoom app an eyebrow filter.
Was
it right after the show yesterday?
Well, we noticed at the beginning of the program, but I was not going to derail your bit with your, do you have fake eyebrows projected on your eyebrows?
It was not subtle. It was not so noticeable that it was over the top. But apparently, I had been playing around with Zoom and giving myself through a Zoom filter artificial eyebrows.
Yes.
Any idiot that's used Zoom knows how that works.
Yeah, you can do Groucho Marx eyebrows. You can do Catwoman penciled eyebrows.
Sure. Now you've got sunglasses.
You can do whatever you want.
You look like an 8-bit Tom Grooze there.
Yeah.
Grooze
here. Oh. What?
Hi, how are you?
Oh, hello.
Someone's stroking out.
Sorry.
Huh?
What?
Yeah, there you go.
See, I'm doing what thousands of people have done.
Well, at least
in their offices.
You do it to your audience and not a Zoom call where you're like, let's just get this over with.
Yeah,
that's right.
Well, that's happy.
See, that's perfect for you.
That is good.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Yeah. A happy emoji frame.
Mr. Optimism.
Very, very, very.
Johnny Optimism.
Look at that. Like,
Mike, let's keep
that
up for
a while. Do I have any friends?
all
right, let's see here. I'm trying to get the...
The eyebrows?
There they are.
Okay.
There you found them. There you go.
Okay.
Let's see. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Hey.
I think it's more prominent because you have white eyebrows.
I don't have white eyebrows.
Well, your eyebrows are light. They're not,
but I don't have gray. Oscar's making me sound like I'm Clarence Darrow.
No, you're not Clarence Darrow. you're not Mark Twain.
What color are they then? I can't tell.
But also, I think, Mike, I think
they're
like
a little
me.
Gray.
When you go to the barber, now you've got a mustache. That's good.
It's a drawn-on mustache,
Dave. When you go to the barber shop, they automatically run a clipper through your eyebrows? Do they trim them for you?
No, not automatically. Sometimes they ask.
Okay, but so you have trimmed. Do you keep them trimmed?
Carla tweezes them.
Okay, all right.
And then
when you're running around with the other two musketeers, what happens?
Hey, answer me these questions. Three. What? I'm playing.
I know.
Now I'm doing this.
Good video.
By the way, if you don't have video, you're screwed.
YouTube, Facebook.
That's it.
But
everywhere.
I like the coming and going of the... Mike, lean into your microphone again and the beard disappears.
There you go.
All right, enough of that. All right. Well, now I know I have to turn them all off.
Yeah, turn off your filters. Turn off your filters.
I think they're all gone. Are there eyebrow filters?
I think the eyebrow filters.
See, that's the thing. They don't just clear everything. Yeah, yeah. There you go.
They're not white, unless you still have something on there.
Yeah.
No, my eyebrows are... Well, that's a little, old man.
Are you using Max Factor?
Something's still on.
Yeah, they're dark. Still,
yeah, they're really dark.
They are very dark.
And little.
Well, I think the size is right.
Is it?
Yeah.
No, my eyebrow filter is off.
It is? Put it back on. This is disturbing.
Are your eyebrows really that color?
Shut up, both of you. All right? Just for
a
second.
Well, a lot of times facial hair matches like your beard, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. That's a cut.
I suppose it's right. Yeah, that's natural.
How would you cut
my
your eyebrows?
My eyebrows are horrible. I have dark eyebrows.
Mm-hmm. You should have Carla pencil them in before you start the show.
Or get some eyebrow bleach.
Yeah, something like that.
You know, Rob, your eyebrows are non-existent, too.
Well, I trim them.
All right, Lex Luthor. You know? I mean, really. I got two horns. I don't want to talk about my eyebrows anymore.
All right, that's fine.
I'll do the show from here.
All right. Yeah. We'll do it live.
We'll do it live.
I love it.
Yeah, so yesterday I just felt a little weird. Oh, by the way, the fan club, thank you for your feedback on the new bit. I have one comment. Like one like on all that. You know what I don't know where to get feedback anymore. I don't know where to get feedback for the show. It's got a long tail. Yeah. I was kind of proud of the work I did, but maybe it's not that big a deal when I do a voice. So, will you count on at least one in 2022?
A new voice? Well, we'll have a new voice debuting. Well, a voice that
new voice that you like in the middle of me trying to debut a voice, you know. I know you like the doctor. I know you like him.
Well, that was during, Mike, that wasn't.
That excited
the,
you.
That wasn't during the other voice. That was during news. It was a totally different segment.
Well, I
don't recall the voice.
I went back and I listened. I don't do that very often. Yeah. I listened to yesterday, and I just want to compliment you two for doing the very best with that bit that could be done. I thought it was the best that you two could do, and it propped it up. So hopefully everything's right with the world.
Are you insulting us now? I felt like that was an insult.
No, that was not a dig. No, why would you think that's a dig? I thought both of you were hysterical with it.
Why are you mad at us because nobody responded to your bit?
I'm not mad at you. Did I say I was? I didn't
say
I was mad at you.
I feel like you're being mean to us now.
How am I being mean right now?
It felt like that could have, like, just on the surface, it felt like that
could have been. No, you thought I was, because you both thought I was being sarcastic.
Right.
I came home and told Carla, I said, Rob and Oscar really got it and really helped me with that yesterday. I think sometimes when, it's not a total home run, I'm a little disappointed.
I thought it was a grand slam.
Yeah, I love it.
Really?
Yes.
People are getting back.
I'm insecure.
People are getting back to work this week, Mike.
Don't be insecure,
all right.
Mike. I mean,
it takes a little while for me to catch
up. It was a great voice, and you know what? It's fun to paint with sound.
Yep. I'm on the air. Turn the machines on.
Is that a new sound effect?
Jesus Christ. What, do you time it? God almighty. Hi.
If you think this is fun, we were in an offline meeting here with one of the building owners.
Yes.
Or the leasing office.
Yeah.
Or the brokers. Who knows? They say, we'll have to look at what it looks like to move some of your studios to another building we own in the city because we'll be using TNT. I
was like, what? Like, explosives?
What happened? What's going
on
here?
They don't know. Well, no, because they're going to have to demolish a lot of the lobby. So just like any other building in the past, like, if, for example, the CBS headquarters in D.C., they built an entire building around the CBS headquarters. Like they remodeled it. They tore it down and rebuilt it around the infrastructure for CBS headquarters and let them operate because they're a national broadcast system, right? They're a massive broadcast entity.
Right.
And they're going to take some of that IP and say, how can we let you guys broadcast from where you are now with minimal interruption while we – and this is for every floor on this building – while we – essentially renovate the building.
But you said TNT.
Might have mentioned that to you before you invested.
No, this is part of the plan the entire time. We knew it was going to happen. We just didn't know what the level of renovation was going to be, right?
Uh-huh. They're going to use explosives?
Yeah, well, Rob, I think that
they're
you and
not
I
are going to use explosives.
He said TNT. Well, he painted the image of a Roadrunner cartoon.
He meant blow up the lobby.
Yeah.
Blow up. That's demo. Not demo. You knucklehead. It's not going to be that they're going to be using dynamite.
When he
dynamite.
Said TNT, what am I to think?
We're not
you
building
think
a
you
metro
immediately
station.
Go to Las Vegas and the old Sands Hotel.
That's what
that
I was hoping. And I was going to tape it.
Well, so when are they planning this renovation?
Well, this is what's great. It's been a moving target for the last 2 years, and we finally have some clarity.
Mm-hmm.
Probably May, but
you're not moving your location, are you?
No, but this is. I think maybe the true takeaway is this:
come down here.
If you own one building in DC,
mm-hmm.
what are the odds you own seven buildings in DC?
So they may move you into another
temporarily.
Building? It's going to be what he loves more than anything else, right?
Struggle,
right?
Struggle.
Does he love building studios and doing and like working
2022
70,
is going to be
hours
a great
a
year for Fantana. Let me tell you,
I'm bringing Mike. I'm going to bring in some dynamite. Just to be
That's
safe.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
All right. Can we bring our talking head in, please?
I wish we would, yes.
Let's do this right now. I know this name.
Yes.
This is a lady that I've met personally, Robin Ferguson. Robin has been listening since 1993 when she lived in Nevada. She now lives in Escondido.
Yes.
Is Escondido. It Escondido?
Escondido. Yes.
Escondido, California, with her 11-year-old schnauzer, Earl, and her husband of 9 years, Rosie, whom she married after a 40-year courtship. I have to ask about that name.
Yeah.
She is a five-time live show attendee. 2 times in Reno, 2 times in Vegas, and 1 time in New Orleans. A mother of 3, Chris is 38. He's a PhD who is the director of the Nevada State Railroad Museum. Tori is 35. She's a Bay Area teacher. And Erica is 29, who is doing better now. Her all-time favorite bit was Tats for Tots. But one of her favorite parts of TMOS is Oscar.
Yay!
What?
What do you think of that, huh?
My
favorite voices are Harry Potter and Charlie. Editor's note, we missed Charlie's birthday this year. He turned 82 on December 13th.
Did you know that, Mike?
I did not. She is an administrator at the Allenberg Racing School, where you can drive open-wheeled formula cars. However, she says that there is not enough Dramamine in the world to make her go 200 miles per hour. As an admin, she handles a lot of duties, including heading up the complaint department. She is an annual Disney pass holder and postcard junkie. As a child, her family had a home in Mexico. She was also behind West Coast. How tired were you at the end when you put this together?
Mike, I did this yesterday afternoon.
This is so robbed.
Mike, I did this yesterday afternoon.
Well, there are typos all over it.
There is a typo. Yeah, I'm sorry. It's a good day for Pony.
And there was she is. I didn't mention the earlier typo when I said she is 5-time live show attendee.
Well, I wanted it to be
where you wrote in Russian.
I wanted to be it in Russian. Yes.
Anyway, Jesus Christ! Swear to God, you don't excel. Ever. Thanks to TMOS, she pines for our next live show so she can reconnect with the best fans and friends in the world. And she once treated Mike and Carla to breakfast in Reno after an all-nighter. That's correct. Intrigued, you should be. Now here's Robin. Robin, that was a massively long, unedited, ill-conceived bio that could have been written so much better. My apologies. It's fascinating to have you on the show. And it looks like you're coming to us from a geisha house in Japan. How are you, Robin?
I'm doing well, thanks. Good morning.
Good to have you.
My apologies. It's still dark here, so the lighting's not the best in the world.
Yes, you had to early rise for us in California today.
We appreciate it. Early rise.
You know what I care about? I care about a backdrop, and I love that back. I don't know. For some reason, your backdrop gives me a
has an peaceful Asian flair.
Easy feeling there. And you have
like a geisha house.
You're one of the core members of the groups that go to our live shows, and we're hoping to do that again in April.
Looking forward to it.
We've got a theme plan that Robin, my 30-year anniversary, and he's barely hanging on. He's barely hanging on right now. So if we can make it for days like this with the level of output that just is incapable of bringing out anything.
And we had a quality control coach come in yesterday.
We had it, and that didn't matter.
Yes,
I have to ask your husband of 9 years, Rosie, tell me about Rosie, your hubby.
Rosie is a nickname. When he was a child, he was on a baseball team and there was 3 Steves on the team. So one of the guys' name was Goodwin, so they named him Goody. The other one, I can't even remember. I think they might have each called him Steve. My husband's last name is Rosenbaum. They called him Rosie. When they started doing that, his dad was in the stands and he started laughing because when his dad was growing up, they called him Rosie too.
Okay.
Oh, that's cool.
For forever.
Now, a 40-year courtship. That is something right there. That is waiting along. So 40 years of knowing this guy. And you wait all that time to finally take the plunge. It just sounds like it might be romantic. It sounds like it might be something special. I got that from the reading that you were courted for 40 years.
kind of, sort of, kind of not. We sat in front, we sat beside each other in Spanish in seventh grade.
Oh, wow.
And we were good friends all through high school, probably best friends, did a lot of stuff together, played over the line together, which is a, kind of a local thing. And then,
boy, I tell you, during the Me Too era, that's an interesting game you're talking about.
Is that like
over the line?
Is that played in the back seat of a car? Or how do you play that?
It's a softball derivative played on the beach, but there's a lot of beer cans involved. Okay, I'll leave it at that.
Okay.
So, so anyways, as we got older, he stayed in San Diego. I moved away to go to college. We both got married. Through the years, we would see each other. We would connect. We'd disconnect. We'd connect. We'd disconnect. We'd go on vacation. We'd disconnect again. And then after my husband passed away, my brother was retiring. So I came back to San Diego for his retirement party. And Rosie and I had recently been in touch. So I said, hey, would you mind doing me a favor? Can you pick me up from where I'm staying? Let's go out and have some lunch and then take me to the airport. I need a ride to the airport. Because who else calls their 40-year-old friend to give them a ride to the airport, right?
Right.
Yeah, very so, cool.
So he did that. And so we started talking. He didn't realize that Bruce had passed away. And so we started talking. A couple months later, he needed a vacation. I was living outside of Carson City. And I said, you know, look, I'm 30 minutes from Reno. I'm 45 minutes from Lake Tahoe. Everybody else comes here to vacation. Why don't you come hang out? We'll have a good time. We had a really good time.
That's wonderful.
And as he says, best vacation ever. And
the
romance started from there. And 2 years later, I moved to San Diego. Rob, I didn't tell you this story. He proposed to me in the bread aisle of the grocery store one day.
Wow.
So that's unusual. But yeah, we had been talking about getting married at breakfast that morning. I didn't want to get married. I was done. I didn't want any more part of being married. But I didn't have health insurance. He says, no, you really need health insurance. You really
How romantic, Robin.
How yeah. romantic. Yeah. We should get married. So I looked at him and I said, are you proposing to me in the Albertsons bread aisle? And he kind of laughed. And he goes, yeah, I think I am. Well, we got married December 24th in Reno, Christmas Eve. January 15th of the following month, I was diagnosed with cancer.
Oh, boy.
It all worked out for the best, and it's been probably the most wonderful 9 years I've ever had. Aww. It's just been fantastic.
And how are you doing? How's your health now? How are you doing?
Very good. One operation took care of all of it, and been free, and everything's great. Didn't fantastic. Have to do chemo or anything else. It was wonderful.
Well, you're a tremendous presence at our live shows, and I want to say thank you for
on
the
and
absolute yes. passionate support for this show, and that makes the difference. That's the only reason we're here. And for those of you that most of the people know this, that are in that that real intimate circle with this show, that know that that's a big deal. The greatest joy I have when we do, and that's why this COVID thing has killed me with not going out and doing shows
not
on the road. It's because of the, I think we're a sideshow for the actual weekend where people come from all over the country and there are friends that have gotten together online. I am hoping that everything goes swimmingly and we all reconvene in April. I really, really can't wait for that. But I wanted to say thank you. And with that positive note, I have a negative note. Now, why is Oscar the one you like the most?
I did not say it that way, but
you
okay.
agreed to this quote. You agreed to this quote, Robin.
I did, because the other one was worse.
Yeah, but we fact checked it.
Yeah. What I said was I really enjoy Oscar's throwaway lines. So many of them get glazed over.
Yeah,
because, and I'm sitting here rolling, and you guys are just moving on and rolling right over it. But I do really enjoy those little throwaway quotes.
I don't want to make this, and just give me a second here, Oscar, because I don't want to make this a blow smoke up Oscar's, you know, but I have to say something yesterday. We are, you know, Oscar will bring things to the table out of left field. Oscar surprises me more than anyone as far as on the show with what he will say and what will come up during the show. When I can bring a snake in, Which is, you know, is fine. I'm bringing a snake. I'm showing a snake that I bought in a pet shop, blah, blah. And then 5 minutes later, Oscar's talking about a person being dragged into the river in Bolivia by an anaconda. I mean, that to me is the, that's the intangible that always works. And I agree with you. And then, you know, Rob, who is Shecky Rob all the time, will, you know, give a line that kills. And I'm entertained more than anybody else on this show every day. I have to say that. I may come in as a curmudgeon. I may get really mad at Rob because he doesn't proofread copy. But ultimately, I get entertained, too. And I'm going to really pull back the curtain about doing a character voice, which I rarely do on the show for a whole segment. But when I do that and I went back and listened to it, I'm listening to these guys. And listening to their reaction to what I'm doing. And that's the part that entertains me. So it's fun for me to do that. But the other great thing about this show is the camaraderie of people that just like our little endeavor here. And that's grown over the years, hasn't it, Robin? As far as, and I'm not talking about grown by numbers. I'm talking about just grown with passion and people that know more about each other and all that, right?
Oh, yeah. When I go on Facebook, it used to be my high school friends or the people I'm involved with now. Now, 90% of my feed is TMOS listeners. And just as friends and as listeners of the show. But we're so involved in each other's lives now. It's not uncommon for me to go to a city that I've never been to before and go, hey, who wants to go grab a beer? And have three or four people respond.
That's cool.
Wow.
And then, you know, it's really cool to be able to know that no matter where I go, I'm going to find a TMOS friend that's going to want to go out, have a beer, have some fun, have some laughs. And then next time I see him at the show, it's like we never even.
It's so cool.
It hasn't been any time since we parted.
You know, if you were an Adam Carolla fan, you could go to those different cities and 30 or 40 people would respond to have a beer. If you were a Joe Rogan fan, 300 or 400 people would respond to that. It's just a dream. It's a dream.
If you were a Joe Rogan fan, they'd respond, but then they'd forget to show up.
They wouldn't want to drink, though. They'd want to. They'd want to do.
Yeah. You follow me on Facebook. You really think I'm going to be a Joe Rogan fan?
No, I don't think so. Not at all. I got to ask about your gig. So you are an administrator. Tell us about, I have no idea what this is, the Allen Berg Racing School, because it sounds super cool.
It is very cool. It's one of the best things I ever fell into in my life.
Okay.
Allen Berg is a former Formula race car driver. He is a Canadian champion. He is a Formula
Stop it. Champion. Sorry.
I know. Sorry. He's in the Canadian Race Car Drivers Hall of Fame. And he runs racing schools out of Laguna Seca in California.
Famous track.
Yeah.
Famous track.
You know, sometimes when I hear you mentioning those Laguna Seca, it's like, Sue, I took the 405 to Laguna Seca and came up the 5. What are you doing here?
What are you doing? Sorry.
Take the 101 to the 23. I'm sorry.
The 101 to the 23.
Highway, dude.
So how is Allen Berg, like many, many moons ago, was he a race car driver? Or
Yeah, he's our age now. So what you can do is it's pretty much a bucket list experience for a lot of people. It's not cheap, I'll tell you that. And you can go for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days. We do accreditation for people that want to learn how to do open wheel racing.
Wow.
But mainly we do bucket list, people that always wanted to drive fast.
But so open, just to make sure I understand, open wheel racing, that's Formula One. And then the other one, what's the other one called? It's Formula
Indy
One.
Racing.
Indy and IndyCar.
Yeah.
That's open wheel, right? That's the cool stuff.
That's open wheel.
That's what
so,
I want to
you
see
know, NASCAR
someday.
NASCAR has fenders. These cars don't have fenders.
I got you. That's
also,
cool.
The whole Dramamine thing is these cars make right turns as well as left turns. They're on road racing courses. So for me to get in a race car at 200 miles an hour, making right and left turns, being strapped in with the helmet, as I said, not enough Dramamine in the world for that.
So you've never even gotten in one to
not
go
true.
Around the track?
I have sat in one, but I have not even gone 25 miles an hour around the track.
Okay, but you run the whole thing.
I have an open invitation. Not my thing.
How fast? Yeah, let's say, you know, somehow we get a vacation or really me.
Right. And you are her favorite after all.
I mean, I'd pay full freight. I want to support where I can support.
You might not know after you hear what it costs.
Well, you know. It's all relative, Mike. I got a lot. What is it? Small interest credit card. You'd be okay.
I believe that if he does a few funny comments, he might get a discount.
Do you have to be a certain size to get in the race car? Because I'm curious.
You have to be at least 5'2". There's that issue. Otherwise, you can't fit the pedals.
Sorry, Dan.
So that's height. What about fat?
Also a weight limit. Yeah, there's a weight limit of around 300, I think, because those are not.
Really? You can get that big a person into one of those things?
I didn't say you'd be comfortable.
Okay. All right. I get it. But I would think I would think like 170 to 225 would be probably the best.
It might be 250, but it depends on the body type.
It keeps going down.
Yeah. Yeah. Mike, you and I might have to do the pit crew.
I reasonably think that Oscar can fit, Pony can fit. Mike, it would be questionable.
Yeah. Right. What about Rob? Robin.
I'm not going there.
No.
Not going there. Yeah, go ahead. Fat joke for me. But
No, I'm saying that I really don't think Rob would fit. And unless it was back to skinny Rob when you lost all the weight.
Not going to happen. Is there a snack bar at this place?
Is there a snack bar? That just sounds cool. So anyway, there's a plug for your business.
But that's not all we do.
What else do you do?
That's not all we do, Mike. We also do driver training for people that test drive autonomous cars.
Ooh.
So in the Bay Area, there's a lot of the people that are starting up the autonomous car industry. When you were in Vegas, you could have taken a taxi that didn't have a driver. They have autonomous taxis in Vegas. But while they're beta testing all of these cars, they need to have real drivers behind the wheel. Mm-hmm. And so we teach accident avoidance and we teach safe driving practices to those people that are beta testing the cars. But what's really cool about it is they get to use the guys that are doing the testing, get to use the test cars.
Oh, wow.
I have NDAs, so I can't tell you who we work for, but I can tell you there are some super cool cars getting ready to come out.
Oh, cool.
Oh, wow. And would you be revealing anything if I said probably a lot of them would be e-cars too? They would be electric cars?
I would not be revealing anything at all. That's definitely the way that the industry is going. If you continue to look, Ford's bringing out all their electrical trucks, cars, the Mustang, which is like one of my favorites. Another new car industry that if you do not want to support Elon Musk, I highly suggest you look at a car called Lucid, L-U-C-I-D.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They have got some beautiful cars out there. I mean, I spec'd out my dream car.
Gorgeous.
For a Lucid.
Yeah.
Wow. You know, the
thing, Robin, about e-cars and the innovation, because I'm a car junkie. I read about cars. I subscribe to Motor Trend and Car and Driver, and I read about cars all the time. The most amazing thing about these e-cars is the horsepower that they're bringing to the table.
It's instantaneous.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it's going to be the difference maker, because ultimately a car guy, and I'm speaking for the guys out there and the ladies that love cars, horsepower is the whole thing. And when you talk about a Tesla Plaid generating over 1,000 horsepower that could kill you easily.
Sure.
But with 0 to 60 in under 2 seconds, you say to yourself, oh my God, it's such an exciting time for automobiles in America right now. What a cool side part of the job at this place, really, the Allenburg Racing School. Wow.
Yeah, really cool. The whole thing that when I first got my hybrid, everybody goes, you know, oh, it's 4-cylinder. I said, yeah. But it's electric. That whole electric part of it just drives those horsepower and just really drives that thing to where you don't even realize it's 4-cylinder. Wow. You're like,
it's amazing.
Take off.
Yeah. You were sort of the head of the complaint department at the racing school. Do you have any complaints that really sort of rise to the top? Because I imagine people, you know, get dissatisfied, I suppose.
Most people love the experience. until they crash the cars and I have to send them an invoice.
Oh my God.
That becomes an issue.
Oh, wow. So if you break it, you bought it type of deal there? Oh,
yeah,
my
know,
God.
We offer insurance, yeah, and it's a very reasonable
buy
rate
the insurance.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. I know what those cars cost. It's a little scary.
Yeah. So we had one kid that chose not to buy the insurance. The experience was a gift from a family member, and I have to be careful how I talk about this. He totaled the car.
Mm. Oh.
Totaled the car. And that was quite a negotiating experience, and being head of the complaint department on that one was my favorite part of the job.
Wow. Well, really, it's so cool to have you on. You've been nice to us. We hung out in Vegas one time, and we posted a picture where you had some stuff that you wanted to give us, and so you said, Carl and I came down to your hotel room, and it was so funny because this picture. Just because it was taken in a hotel room, we got more, correct. What's going on in there? Oh, hey, how are you? And it was just, you've been such a wonderful supporter of my wife and I. And that was, I think that may have been, had Carl and I just finished like literally an all-nighter gambling? Had we done
pretty
that?
Pretty much. The story behind that is you had your, I was staying at the Silver Legacy because I lived in the area, knew better than to stay at Circus. No offense to Circus.
Yeah,
but
I get it.
So you had your little voucher that they had given you for your free breakfast and you were trying to redeem it at the Silver Legacy.
Oh, and so it was a Circus voucher at the wrong hotel?
Correct.
Sounds about right.
After an all-nighter?
I've gone all night. We've done the show.
And I offered to use my comps to pay for your breakfast. And you were like, no, I've got this. I go, no, really, honestly. I mean, the degenerate gambler that I am, please let me buy your breakfast. So you and Carla and I sat and had a wonderful buffet.
Yep.
Discussed my children's lives while Carla ate Brussels sprouts for breakfast.
Yeah, that's my healthy wife. That is my healthy wife. Well, I'm really, really, happy to have you on the show. And you have been a big supporter. And you have so many people here. Is there anybody specifically you want to say hello to before we let you go, Robin? Because it's been so much fun talking about your gig, which I've never done, I don't think, with you. I don't know whether I've mentioned that or not.
I do want to shout out to my BFF Ride and Die, which is Jen Tackett, who got me started on the show 30 years ago.
Oh, wow.
Love her to death, and just wish I could spend more time with her. And then a big shout out to the O'Mara chicks, Jolene, Kristen, Shebe. Can't wait to see you in New York in May, Shebe. And just all the other gals that just make this such a great time. You know, the people, like you said, Mike, I love you guys. The shows are great. But man, the times we have in the bars afterwards and the things we go out and do before.
Yeah, we're just a bunch of rummies. We're just a bunch of rummies. Robin, thank you. Thank you so much.
You,
and we hopefully will see you in April when we get our stuff together. I'm optimistic.
Yeah.
I would say it's a better chance of happening than not, right? That's the way it's going.
Yeah, there's a chance.
Sure, it's looking
before,
like it.
Said the man who just canceled another weekend getaway, you know, because he's terrified of the bug. Yes. Yes, Robin.
If you guys have it, I'll be there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. Bye-bye. That's Robin Ferguson, everybody. We got to take a break, and we will be back with more fun on the Mike O'Mara Show. I love the talking headset.
Hit me. The TMOS bonus show has what listeners crave.
It's got electrolytes.
If you like TMOS, join Mike, Rob, and Oscar for the TMOS bonus show every week.
Why don't we just try it and not worry about what plants crave?
Yeah, it's got electrolytes.
What are electrolytes? Do you even know?
Buy it for yourself or give it to a friend and help the show grow.
Like out the toilet?
I've never seen no plants grow out of no toilet.
The time is now to subscribe to the TMOS bonus show.
Do it. Do it now.
Click the banner at Mike O'Mara Show.
It's got electrolytes.
It does have electrolytes. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by KiwiCo. A new year is a great time to discover new things about our interests, and it's just as important for kids to make these same discoveries. With a KiwiCo subscription, your child can make new discoveries all year long. Kids can explore the engineering behind everyday objects, the science and chemistry of cooking, geography and culture, and art and design techniques, all through fun, hands-on projects. Mike Michael loves his crates from KiwiCo, and I love watching him stay busy and challenged while having a blast. From discovering the science of magic to engineering a domino machine, kids can explore new worlds and rediscover familiar ones without even leaving home. As a parent, it can be hard to find creative ways to keep your children busy, especially in this day and age, and keep them challenged as well. KiwiCo does the legwork for you, plus you can pause or cancel anytime. Redefine learning with play and get 50% off your first month plus free shipping on any crate line with code TMOS at KiwiCo.com. That's 50% off your first month at KiwiCo.com. Promo code TMOS, everybody.
From the four corners of the World Wide Web and into your digital device, it's what you need to know. This is the homepage.
I don't know why I begin the homepage with this today, but I don't know. It just kind of got to me. I'm not a romantic, but and I've never had this guy lead the news. Machine Gun Kelly. He put a lot of detail into the design of Megan Fox, her engagement ring.
Oh, okay.
I just realized myself now why I led with this story.
Okay.
I'm not right.
Something subliminal happening there? Or?
Not really. You'll get it as soon as that. So his, the engagement ring, he designed it including thorns on the bands of the ring with the stones.
All right.
In an interview in Vogue, he said, quote, "The bands are actually thorns. So if she tries to take it off, it will hurt."
Oh.
Love is pain. Mm. That was his quote. Love is pain. When he posted about the ring last week, he also said it represented, quote, here you go. Here's the artist.
Yeah.
"Two halves of the same soul forming the obscure heart that is our love." And by the way, there was a Instagram of the proposal with like multiple camera shots too of him getting down on one knee. And she still manages to look stunning.
You know,
in
it's
my humble opinion.
The engagement ring is kind of like a downtown parking garage. Do not back up.
Do not back. You know, I'm just wondering, you know, if the rings are valuable enough and you put the right kind of band, you know, where, you know, you'll dig into your.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I don't know if. I guess you could have a diamond cut you if you needed to.
Well, he's talking about the band.
No, it's only the
band.
Wouldn't there be diamonds on a band?
So the thorns would like dig into the skin, you see.
Well, I guess what material would the thorns be?
Band would be white gold, platinum, gold, whatever, you know, something.
Caramel.
Silver, caramel, yeah.
Something.
Tungsten. Yes. Anywho, let's move on. That was my lead story. Why, I don't know. Our good friend, he's not our good friend, but he's our, we love him, Louis Anderson.
Yes.
Was great on the show. He's in a Las Vegas hospital battling cancer, which is bad news. His rep said that he has diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, and he's resting comfortably. Louis appeared in the 1988 comedy Coming to America, as well as last year's sequel. He also has hosted Family Feud, and he played Zach Galifianakis' his mother on the FX show Baskets.
Great show.
Louis has the same kind of cancer as Mark Hoppus of Blink 182. After 6 months of his treatment, Hoppus announced he was cancer free in September. And apparently, you probably know more about this than I do, Rob, but in the cancer department, this is a curable form of the disease. So, Louis, kick its ass.
Do it, man.
F cancer and get it done.
Do you know Robert was in treatment for about 3 years and 8 months for his leukemia, and he remains cancer-free. But advances were made just during his treatment. That's how they're advancing with cancer treatment. And every day, it's a different treatment and an improved treatment. And so, fingers crossed, they do amazing, amazing
work. I rarely say this on the show, but when you go to an auction, when you go to a benefit, when you see something online, when you see a cancer fun run, when you see a walkathon, whatever, you know, support, support, support. And it does make a difference because this money does change lives.
It does.
They do put it into research. And when it comes to things like the American Heart Association, the American Cancer Society, these things, they add up. You don't see it away, but you know it does work. So please help when you get a chance. Daniel Radcliffe, you know him, Harry Potter. You'll be sorry, Harry Potter. He works pretty hard to not be typecast as that Potter kid. This should definitely help. And I'll tell you, there's a segment of our audience that's going to be excited about that. He's going to star in a biopic about Weird Al Yankovic.
He's going to play Al?
It's called Weird, the Weird Al Yankovic story.
Wow.
It'll be available for free on the Roku channel. There's a Roku channel? All right.
There is now.
Production begins in February. Al said that when my last movie, UHF, came out in 1989, I made a solemn vow to my fans that I would release a major motion picture every 33 years. He's funny. He's a, you know, he beyond the music, and he's kind of a dirt.
I like that he's on Roku and not a mainstream platform.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's like
and
being
it's
on Pluto.
Funny what he said. I made a promise to my fans. I release a motion picture
remember
every 33 years.
So great the movie UHS gave us this.
There's just one place to go for all your spatula needs.
Spatula City. Spatula City.
A giant warehouse of spatulas for every occasion.
Right. So that's great. It. Spatula City. I'm very happy to say we're on schedule. He added that he believes this is the role that future generations will remember Radcliffe for. That's just funny. Look, you know what? Talk about the power of a really funny human being that can come out and make a couple of things make me want to watch the movie. That's just funny what he said, you know, Harry Potter.
You know what? He's had such staying power, and he is so respected in the business now because I think musically he's very strong. He really does understand music as a format. And also, he wrote a children's book that Michael loved, right?
Which was one of the best I've ever.
Yeah.
Was that Farkle McBride?
I believe that was the name
of
it.
No, or that might be John Lithgow. I'm not sure.
I'll find out
which it is because it was a good one.
That sounds right.
More people are embracing mental health days. That's when you take a sick day because you're stressed or overworked and not necessarily sick. So which day of the week is best for a mental health break? The answer is whenever you need one. But if you can plan ahead, Wednesdays might not be the best day for it.
Really?
Sorry. Huffington Post recently did a write-up on how Wednesdays are tempting because it breaks up the week. But here are two reasons why it might not be the best choice. Number one, Wednesdays usually aren't the most relaxing day to take off. You'll be coming down from work on Tuesday, and you'll end up stressing about having to be back at work on Thursday. Well, okay, just quit then. You know what I mean? I mean, give me a break so it won't end up feeling like a real full day off. Okay, that's overthinking. Number two, people you work with are more likely to notice and ask questions. When you take a day off in the middle of the week, people want to know why. Mm-hmm. So you'll either have to deflect or be honest and admit you're struggling. You're struggling a little bit right now. That's what I said to the guys when I took Wednesday off a week ago. I said, I'm struggling, guys.
Struggling.
You're both so kind. You said, well, it might get
take
well.
Take a day.
And
take
the weird,
day.
The weird thing well. Is when you didn't show up on Wednesday, we notice.
Get well. Get well soon.
Feel well.
And now a little something, something. Here is a new dating hack made possible by the pandemic. A woman in the UK is going viral after she used a fake COVID test to get out of a bad date.
Oh, no.
So she's on a date with this guy.
Yes.
She goes to the bathroom in the middle of her date and got a friend to text her fake test results. So it looked like she'd tested positive. She changed their name in her phone so it looked official. And they included a line that said she was probably infectious.
Oh, no.
She showed the guy the text, said she had to leave immediately, and he didn't say a word. He didn't even question it. How could you? You're right. Not going to question that. Then she met up with a friend, went to a club, and hooked up with a different dude.
Oh, no.
I just wonder if the guy she hooked up with decided whether or not to show her his positive herpes test. There you go. Thank you. Thank you very much.
What,
pretty cool move. You
what
know?
Variant was that?
I got to go to a club now. The variant. The Hua variant. We got to take a break. We will come back with more fun and more thrills. You, ladies and gentlemen, are listening to the Mike O'Mara Show. Whoa, whoa.
This is Z Wants Candy.
Shannon.
Thanks, Peach.
I like
Dexter.
To snack.
Well, we should have something sweet.
She loves candy.
Airheads. They're sour. Sour Patch. The watermelon flavored ones.
Sweet Tarts.
Nerds. Black Licorice.
Shannon.
Good and Plenty. Chocolate.
A Hershey bar.
Peanut butter cup.
Mary Jane's.
Watermelon.
Bit of
I ate all of my favorite candies.
Don't worry, Peach. You can stock up on all your favorites through the Mike O'Mara Shopping Center. Click the banner at MikeO'MaraShow.com.
Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, everybody. We want to welcome freshly back to the Mike O'Mara Show. Food that's fast doesn't have to be fast food. Freshly offers quality meals without the hard work. Their meals are designed by nutritionists, cooked by chefs, then delivered fresh to your door. Other meal deliveries need to be prepped and cooked, but Freshly is ready to eat in 3 minutes, and Oscar is a little bit excited that Freshly's back on the air with us, ladies and gentlemen. Your freezer is, refrigerator, still full of it. Yeah, absolutely.
The fridge at work, the fridge at home. All Freshly's all the time. And pro tip for those of you at home still with your kids.
Yes.
Maybe they're homeschooling now. Don't worry about making them lunch. If you get Freshly's, you just throw in the microwave. You're good to go.
Absolutely.
3 minutes. Yeah. Ready to eat in 3 minutes. No one wants to spend an hour cooking dinner after a rough day at work or an infuriating commute. So skip the grocery shopping and dirty dishes. Your Freshly meals arrive cooked and fresh every week. Use the Freshly website or app to find meals that fit your lifestyle with plans that work for your dietary needs, preferences, tastes, and family size. And stop stressing about dinner, people. Yep. Right now, Freshly is offering our listeners $40 off your first two orders when you go to Freshly.com/TMOS. That's $40 off Freshly.com/TMOS. All right. So Rob wanted to talk about a TV show that's back on now. You've been a big fan of it. It's been out for a million years. So it's a rehash. It's the Righteous Gemstones.
It's the second season.
It's the second season. And it's been almost a year and a half since the first season.
Because of the COVID, their production schedule was messed up. I think it's a great cast with John Goodman.
Danny
McBride's in it. It's just, it's fun. It's fun. Suspend disbelief when you're watching it, and you'll have a really good time
The plot line this season that is so funny to me, because, and again, this is kind of like that movie Don't Look Up. It is so close to being something that could really happen. They just turn the knob a little bit. For example, in episode 1 and 2, they're trying to talk the father into investing into a Christian timeshare resort. And
because they want to be hoteliers.
They want to be, and that's the word
Well, the whole PTL, the model, right?
Yeah.
The model of those businesses. And they go back, what I think they do with the Righteous Gemstones is they go back in time a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because that's the kind, really, 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 back in the day. And I cut my radio teeth during these years of Jimmy Swaggart. And Oral Roberts. And when you go back in time, they were really, hey, mama, we're going to do this like that. They came out of the Swaggart. I remember Jimmy Swaggart when
Jessica
he came out.
Hahn.
He said, Jessica Hahn, all that stuff with PTL, Jim Baker, Tammy Faye. And I think... And this is, it's just a much more sophisticated model nowadays.
What they've done is they've
separate
really.
Separate people from their money.
With
big
the
time.
Super churches.
They've really turned it into like a rock and roll experience. And what's great.
Austin, right? Is that the guy Joel Austin?
Joel Austin. Comes to mind?
Was it Austin?
Osteen.
Osteen. He's everywhere.
Osteen. But what's happened is that the siblings on Gemstones have all sort of gotten their own angles. Like Danny McBride is the one that's taking on the hotelier business. But what's great is the youngest son, Andy Devine, has the God Squad, and they're all muscle men. And there's
don't give away the undertones. The undertones are funny.
Is one plot line. I'll give it to him because he's going to love it.
All right.
It's a throwaway. It's just like one of these underlying options where you're like, what is going on? So, Danny McBride has three sons. And then one of his sons is coming into his own, right?
So to speak.
But he's leaving all of this evidence all over the house.
Like hiding it to be found.
So he's just leaving it places. And no dad wants to talk to his son about this. So he goes to his... oldest son to talk to his youngest son to say, hey, we've got a problem with the young one. You guys are closer in age. You go talk to him.
Oh, God, he palms it off because he's such a terrible father that he palms it off to
and
him
then
like that.
You see how that plays out. But just the idea of them rolling that into the plot line, it's hilarious.
Mike, there's only three episodes. It's on HBO. You can stream it. You should watch all three tonight. You can get them done in one night. And all three of them play so well together.
Since we do this periodically on this show, we do it a lot on the show as we're all cooped up here. I'm watching a listener recommended Yellowjackets on Showtime right now.
Tell me about it. I've heard a lot about it, but not enough about it.
It's relatively slow moving. They take a lot of time getting through different episodes, but I haven't been able to turn it off yet because I think it's fascinating. And a lot of flashbacks. In fact, the whole thing is based on present day and in the past, a tragedy that happens to this soccer team.
Okay.
This is one that I don't want to give any plot lines about, but you do get to see the principals in present day, the two most notable, Juliette Lewis, who I think was most famous for Natural Born Killers. And if you go way back to when she was a kid, Counselor, Cape Fear, De Niro.
She was in a vacation movie, too. Was it Christmas Vacation?
Natural
she
Born
was,
Killers.
Yeah.
Natural Born Killers. Yeah, that. So. And have you watched it, Oscar? Have
oh,
you
yeah.
looked in on it?
Every episode.
All right. Juliette Lewis is not yet, I think she's not 50 yet. I don't think she's 50.
Oh, I don't
yet.
Know how she is, but they have put some miles on her character.
It is something to behold. I don't know how much is real.
Well, she's a recovering drug addict in the movie.
She is. She has to look haggard.
Yeah.
You
she's
know.
2 years younger than me. She's 48.
She's 48 years old. Mm. And Shannon
actually commented on it because
Carla comments on it every time she's on
as,
screen.
And I guess, is it fate? I don't know. As fate would have it. Juliette Lewis was in my wife's yoga studio when 3 years ago, taking classes. I guess she was filming a movie in DC, and she would
really?
Just drop in and take classes. And she's like, "Do you know who this actress is?" I'm like, "Yes." And she goes, "Well, she comes in for classes on a regular basis for 2 weeks." And everybody's been like,
I bet.
Yeah, right? She's a major player.
Right
yeah,
before
absolutely.
COVID struck and Shannon was still teaching. And I said, well, what does she look? She's like, she's beautiful. So when she sees Yellowjackets, she's like, that's
okay.
all makeup. That's
yeah,
all makeup.
I think that they do real job making her look hagged out.
Yes.
They really, really do. And Christina Ricci is the other
Wednesday
one who plays
Adams.
Wednesday Addams.
Looks
and,
nothing like Wednesday Addams.
No, but she does have the creep factor. I read an article about she plays an ostracized character on this show, and she's totally weird. And she had said that when she puts the makeup, which is a kind of a nerdy curly haired wig with large glasses, she said that when she would get into character and put on the makeup for this role, she would be treated like crap by the crew.
Oh, no. I bet.
And she had to remind them that she was number three on the call sheet, which I thought was hysterical.
Because she
really
looks
did.
Like such a, like, and I please excuse this term, just nerds rule the world, but she looks like such a nerd with her braces and the characters would all treat her the way that she set up in the dynamic of the group. She's low man on the pole.
Right.
So when you see what she does in this show.
This
and
I urge
41
everybody
now, so she's older if you
look in on Playing Yellowjackets, you're gonna kind of figure out that something bad's gonna happen because they show it to you right at the beginning.
Okay.
But then it's the ramp up. And I think as a guy, I don't know if you felt the same way, Oscar. I'm saying to myself, okay, you know, when's the real bad stuff going to happen? I'm bored.
Well, you know what?
I'm bored.
That is,
I want to get to
it. Gets
I want
it gets
now,
better.
now. Okay,
it's
good,
set
good.
Up like a film noir then. You already know the ending, and they have to work backwards towards it. So
yeah, you kind of know the ending. You know something really bad happens. Anyway, that's our TV recommendation. I wanted to give that to you. We will take a break, ladies and gentlemen. And a lot of you are concerned about getting out of the COVID scare and traveling more. Summer will be here before you know it, and people are going to go on vacation. Will 5G? This seems like Y2K.
Yes, it does.
Will 5G destroy airports? We'll be right back.
The Mike O'Mara Show.
Probably have a couple beers.
TMOS.
2, 3, 4.
A full-bodied podcast.
Sometimes wine.
With earthy tones of pop culture and a bouquet of comedy, wit, and sarcasm.
Do you drink every night, Pony?
Yeah. I'll have a martini about 5 o'clock.
The Mike O'Mara Show.
Sometimes 4 to 6 beers.
A drinking show.
4 or 5 drinks.
With a radio problem.
How am I alive?
Watch the live feed weekdays at MikeO'MaraShow.com or download it wherever you get your podcasts.
Thank you very much. This portion of the Mike O'Mara Show is brought to you by our good friends at Stamps.com. If you are a small business owner, you're busy enough as it is. You don't have time to deal with going to the post office. With Stamps.com, you can skip the trip and never waste another dollar or minute. Stamps.com lets you print official postage right from your computer. For more than 20 years, Stamps.com has been a must for over 1 million businesses. Stamps.com gives you access to all the post office and UPS shipping services you need, and it gets you discounts that you can't find anywhere else, like up to 40% off USPS rates and, listen to this, 76% off UPS. Whether you're an office sending invoices, a side hustle, Etsy shop, or a full-blown warehouse, Stamps.com will make your life easier. Send anything anywhere with Stamps.com. Save time and money this year with Stamps.com. You can sign up with promo code TMOS for a special offer that includes a four-week trial, free postage, and a digital scale. And no long-term commitments or contracts. Just go to Stamps.com, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage, and enter the code TMOS. And I'd like to say personally thank you, Stamps.com, for advertising on this show for as long as you have.
Yes.
We appreciate it, and keep doing it through 2022, people. Welcome back to the show. What is going on, Oscar? You're the technical person. I have no idea what this 5G will mean for airports, but people are starting to. It's the next thing that we can get depressed and panicked
about. And it doesn't
about.
Have anything to do with the burger joint,
You shouldn't be depressed. This 5G revolution for creators like your boys here is. This is what I've been beating the drum about for years now about 5G. Is the access to high-speed internet across the country finally at a level where
been in countries in Asia for
years. Correct, but the infrastructure had to be purchased, and then someone had to invest in building out what is the spectrum so we could use it for having a gig download speed on our mobile devices. What does that mean, Oscar? If you do a speed test at home, anybody's ever done it, if you're lucky, especially if you're residential, if you get 300 or 400 down, that's because you're paying a premium to the cable company, and if you're getting that, it's amazing. Your up speeds are probably terrible. With 5G, if you're lucky enough to have this on your block, I don't care how ugly the transmitters are, some people are complaining about that, you will be able to get 1,000 down, no problem on your mobile device. And if you can get 1,000 down on your mobile device, what can you get in your home off of 5G
mobile? So you're excited about this?
Yes. Now,
well, how's it going to mess up airports?
Well, unfortunately, and a lot of people are blaming the FAA, is for years now, Verizon has been banging the drum about 5G, and AT&T has, where they say, look, we've bought the spectrum, we're bringing it to the world, including, you know, highly populated areas, especially around cities that are built around airports like Los Angeles or New York.
Mm-hmm.
And what the FAA is saying is that the altimeters on the plane may have some interference with the 5G spectrum. So when you're flying in fog or someone's
about to... Or the 5G spectrum will interfere with the altimeters.
With the altimeters, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, on the plane. So if...
So, I mean, but it's the other way is what I meant, right?
Yes, yes.
That the 5G will mess up
the altimeter,
you know, the planes that are up there.
Yes, and what does an altimeter do? It measures your altitude. So when a plane is landing and they're using the altimeter, for the pilots are using that to see how far they are from the ground.
1,000. 20.
So that's the concern they have.
Well, I have a flight simulator I got for my kid. So you do it that. By the way, if you've ever done this, and I'm dorky enough where I've watched pilots landing videos, and I also do a flight simulator, it goes 1,000, 500, 4, 100, 50, 20. 10. That's how they do it. And they're saying, so when it gets close to the ground, it won't
because of the 5G spectrum, which it...
Well, Jesus, now I'm freaked out. My ass, consider it, color me freaked out.
Mike,
this has been background noise on the news. Now I'm terrified. I hate to fly anyway. I'm not flying.
Mike, the 5G, when they fly into 5G, the altimeter, instead of going 1,000, it goes,
You may get a bad reading.
It's like it has a stroke. One.
You're familiar, of course, with the aircraft carrier Emirates, right?
No.
The Dubai-based Arab Emirates.
Aircraft carrier?
Yeah, it says Dubai-based
Emirates. I love when you're like, the airline,
not aircraft carrier.
Airline, Emirates, a key carrier for the East-West travel, has halted flights to Boston, Chicago, Dallas-Fort Worth, Houston, Miami, Newark, New Jersey, Orlando, San Francisco, and Seattle, and it's mostly a problem with the Boeing 777.
And shocker, the 777, old Boeing.
The 777. Let's, what's the plane that's going to be messed up? What's the one that can carry the most people?
That's right.
777, yeah, okay, let's, Jesus, now I'm freaked out.
So,
check the altimeter.
What's the solution?
What's the solution? I'm asking you. I hope you know.
Well, the FAA needs to get off their ass, and I'm sure we have government listeners right now. That maybe work for the agency, because it seems to me that they had a long runway to understand that this was coming.
Speak. Pardon the pun.
I think this would be because of the big. This is a black eye for all these government agencies.
Sure.
And the bloat that goes in.
Is this tied into infrastructure to a degree?
Well, no.
Where we just didn't put in with all our airport. You know,
the FCC clears the road for spectrum, right? There's like, hey, we're going to have a spectrum auction. Everybody come buy this.
Right.
So the FCC then, once they sell it, you think would talk to the FAA and say, hey, they're launching in 2022. Mm-hmm. Make sure you shore up your altimeters around airports, because you know who's done it before, Mike? 40 plus nations around the world have already figured this out, and 5G has launched.
All right. This from today. Here's an update. Wireless carriers Verizon and AT&T say they will go ahead with plans to switch on high-speed 5G service nationwide Wednesday, except near airports and runways due to worries that high-tech radio signals could interfere with them. I love could.
Could.
Know. Maybe a little definitive. Yeah. Can we do that? You know, Frankie, shut up. I'm talking about 5G.
He's been this way ever since they rolled out 5G, Mike.
Yeah. Wow.
But
high-tech radio signals, so they're delaying rolling it out near
airports. These are the airports.
This is New York, so what
Houston,
we are.
Los Angeles. Nothing about D.C. So we should be A-okay if we want to think about just your own backyard for
yeah,
our D.C.
it's
listeners.
Okay. So they're not doing it in D.C., but if you're flying to Orlando, you know.
Yeah.
This is freaky.
Yeah, they're going to continue flights to L.A., New York, and
by the
Washington,
way, I should point out, though, that altimeters are also, you know,
it's
you have digital
technology.
And you have analog,
yeah,
right?
This is analog bullshit.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Sorry, buddy.
Oh, my God. That's BS.
So
by the way, Frankie, when I take you outside in the morning, I haven't visited this topic in a while. When I take you outside and you look at me like, with your big eyes even bugged out more, I know you dumped somewhere in the house.
Mike.
When you don't go, yes, hi.
Once we get past this this drama about the 5G, what I think is going to happen is people are going to realize that the speed that they're getting on their newer devices and in their home now is going to change and revolutionize the way we do business.
Instantaneous texts, Mike, to tell people that you're going to crash.
All right, but here's the thing, and I think everybody agrees. This is related to
the metaverse,
when they tell you to turn off your cell phone when you're on an airplane.
Yes.
It's that similar. It's interference is what they're concerned about.
Yeah.
You know, and the 5G, you're talking about wireless. That's the big thing. I mean, that's the it's not the, when you talk about downloads, you're talking about being able to generate those download speeds of 1,000 mm-hmm. on a wireless device.
Yes.
Yeah.
I sound like Jeff Goldblum. On a device that'll fit in your hand. Isn't that amazing? However, if you're going to fly a 777 into LAX, let's not get too eager.
Hey, Jeff.
Let's not get too eager.
How far up in the air are we?
Yeah. I really can't tell you because the altimeter's effed. I'm sorry. It wasn't a question of whether we should roll out wireless 5G. It was a question of whether we should.
They had...
Let's take a little pirated line from Jurassic Park.
No expense was spared.
They had the CEO of Verizon on Squawk...
Richard Attenborough.
They Squawk Box this morning. And they were pressing this mother effer on yelling at somebody. He's like, I'm a patient man. And I'm sitting there, and I'm like, and he's got the Hans and Franz accent. He's got a German accent. And he's like, and they're like, somebody's got it. Like, so the guy's like, but somebody's to blame. Like, the bloat in government. He goes, we're just going to do what the, like he, this is a man that's built for this BS, right? Because right. they just right. want him to misstep. He goes, that is beyond me. I don't have all the details. I just know we are launching. We're just not launching around airports. I think people are making.
You know what? Here's the way I look at it.
We are not launching near airports.
We are not going to launch near the Los Angeles International Airport. This is what. I look, when we have stories like this, you know, that scare us.
Yes. Yeah.
And you know, there's nothing. There is. Listen, if you're a news director at a major network mm-hmm. or you're a news director at a local television station, there is nothing that gives you a
right.
more than a terrifying story.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
More than a you know, if somebody calls in and go, I found actual real mosquito larvae in my water. Get the crew out to that house right away.
But to say that,
hold on, let me finish my point. The point I'm trying to make is that when we know about it, to me, that's better than a, you know, what would be a problem is if a, wow, this 5G on my phone, spectacular. I just got a news alert that, you know, Spirit Flight 35 crashed into the swamp. Then there would be a problem.
Yes.
But, you know,
they get excited about terror and they really love terror on airplanes. And so this is a perfect
piece. Absolutely. Mike, but the fact that we know what my point
we
is
know,
that it's a
we
good
know
thing.
This. Right. But imagine, right. you know, Joe Public, they're like, what is 5G? And why are they doing this to us?
You know, I'm on my little, I haven't even showed you, but I'll bring it there. I can show you right now. This is part of my flight simulator that I have here. I'm going to see if I can. You see my yoke?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, look
that's
that.
My throttle.
Got it, yeah.
That's my throttle that I have. And they've got a thing called Flight School. And so on Flight School, they show you by this, you know, it's supposed to be, it's the most sophisticated gaming platform mm-hmm. for a PC. Mm-hmm. It's really amazing mm-hmm. how you have these planes with this detail and the scenery that you have. And then when they do the flight school, they're showing me the different instruments on a Cessna, right?
Right.
And I'm literally saying to myself, I'm going to pay attention. And with my blind ass, if you're going to really be detailed, perhaps the giant fat cartoon arrow that you use that's really pointing at four different gauges is not the right way to do it. So I'm still trying to
when Michael's away at school or, you know, out of the house, you ever role play with Carla about being the pilot?
No, to be honest with you, that doesn't happen.
You're not running around like Leo DiCaprio and Catch Me If You Can?
Right. I'm not going to say what I could say right now.
This is my
throttle. No,
this is my throttle. Huh?
No, it's just my throttle. It's a detail of something that I at 62, it's not becoming for me to kiss and tell.
I understand.
I just want to say that my bed frame.
Hmm.
Is too wide for the mattress, you know?
Okay.
And it's just not, it's not really good with sexy time when you said, when you, you know, in the throes of the golden opportunity to be with one of the most beautiful women I've ever known in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and as opposed to just, you know, taking that sweet moment of intimacy, instead of that, you know, just loving life and being in the moment and all that, you know, you're like going, my shins hurt. Thank you. That's it. We have to take a break. I had to say that. I had to get that off my chest. She was very open and honest with her reaction, too. Great. Anyway, seriously. I mean, if there's like the gardener or something down the street, you know, I'm more power to you, Carla. I get it. I know I'm not there anymore.
Oh, boy.
We'll be right back. Oh, boy.
Hello, friends. It's me, Jake the Snake. America's most beloved ball python. The greatest snake in history. Just a reminder, dear boy, don't forget to purchase the TMOS bonus show, an uncensored, commercial-free, extra TMOS episode every week. Costs only pennies and supports Mike and Rob and Oscar. It's the best. Buy it now at MikeOmeraShow.com. And for those of you who say I sound like the Leesburg Vulture, listen. This is the voice Mike uses for all his creepy animals. So piss off and thank you.
Thanks, Jake. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by Our Crowd. All around the world, tech companies are innovating and driving returns for investors. Our Crowd analyzes companies across the global private market, and they select those with the greatest growth. the greatest growth potential. Then they bring them to you, whether it's personalized medicine, cybersecurity, robotics, quantum computing, and whether it's in state-of-the-art labs, startup garages, or anywhere in between. Our crowd is identifying innovators, so you can invest when growth potential is greatest. Early, our crowds, when it's greatest early.
Yeah, early.
Our crowd's accredited investors have already invested over $1 billion in growing tech companies, and many of their members have benefited from the 46 IPOs or sale exits of their investments. Now you can truly diversify your portfolio by investing early in innovative private market companies at Our Crowd. Join the fastest growing venture capital investment community at ourcrowd.com/TMOS. Again, that's ourcrowd.com/TMOS, and a big thank you to Our Crowd.
Did you hear that?
Listen to the sound.
Do you hear
the sound?
There's a new sound.
The sound's new.
Sound Town.
Things must be bad, Mike. Things
yes.
must be bad.
Well, a lot of stuff is bad, Rob. We can't help that.
Luckily, people in show business, they have our back. Tyler is bringing back Madea.
Oh, really? You mean there's going to be another Madea's Family Christmas?
Or you guys weren't a big fan?
It's called Madea's Homecoming. And here's the thing. He went on record in 2013 saying he's tired of the character himself.
You must never get tired of playing Madea. That must be so much fun.
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I do.
It's just hilarious.
But you know what it is? It's the joy that it gives to the people, just like you coming in here and how it uplifts you.
You know,
no matter what's going on, we have great lives, but you come in and people have such great energy, you want to keep doing it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can pass.
Really?
Yeah.
We don't ever get tired of saying that.
Well, thank you, honey. I thank you so much for that. Thank you so much.
Have you ever seen any of the films?
I never have.
Mike?
Never.
They're good. They're funny.
Transformers, good?
No, I want to hate on it. They're funny.
I'm not prepared to dispute you. I just have never thought about it.
They're funny.
You
know? You're like, this is why this guy's a zillionaire.
He has all the money. He really does.
You know,
I've always thought if I watched one of the Madea movies, I'd have to turn in my credentials as the White Devil.
They're good.
You
know?
You can sign a waiver, I think.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
But you know, I worry when you meet.
Eddie
Murphy.
Yeah. If you like Eddie Murphy or you like Mrs. Doubtfire, it's the same premise.
Yeah.
It's the same premise.
I like neither.
Oh.
Oh, I mean, I loved Mrs. Doubtfire.
I love Mrs. Doubtfire.
You would go on and on about it.
I hated Mrs. Doubtfire.
Well, you were also going through a divorce at the time.
No.
That was probably
the
tough.
Worst use of Robin Williams ever.
He's
and
right.
Way overrated.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
right.
Pony.
Oh, he's just a lot of makeup.
Doubtfire?
I loved Mrs. Doubtfire.
Yeah, as a kid, it was like the best.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, it's like a prison movie. All right. Anyway. I watched that one. Yeah.
The political ads are starting up, and I like this guy in Louisiana. He's not only in favor of legalizing marijuana, he's running an ad where he's smoking a doob.
Okay.
This is a candidate. His name is Gary Chambers.
States waste $3.7 billion enforcing marijuana laws every year. Most of the people police are arresting aren't dealers, but rather people with small amounts of pot, just like me. I'm Gary Chambers, and I'm running for the U.S. Senate. And I approve this message.
Vote for a man.
Family Dollar Weed.
Meanwhile, in Arizona.
He sounds exactly like the Neelys.
He does. He really does.
Family Dollar Bowl and Bong.
Now, I'm curious, Oscar, you were an Arizona resident.
Yes.
Here's a candidate for Senate in Arizona. Is this guy got the means to win?
If you are pissed off about the direction of our country, let's go. If you're ready to secure the border and stop the invasion, let's go. If you want to keep corrupt politicians from rigging elections, let's go. Yeah. I'm Jim Layman. Let's take the fight to Joe Biden and show him we the people put America first. The time is now. Let's go, Brandon. Are you with me? I'm Jim Layman, and I approve this message.
There you go.
What a loser.
Yeah, yeah. So politics
are
afoot.
I want to barf when I see that.
Politics are afoot.
Well, this is why we need to be ever vigilant.
Yes, this is true.
Because
yeah,
this is happening.
And unfortunately, I think I, like a lot of people, like-minded political people, sit on the sidelines and just sigh and exhale. And look, do not underestimate these folks.
You're right.
The Let's Go Brandon folks.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
The passion. I don't care if you read an article in the Daily Beast about his act is tired. No, it's not. No. You do not underestimate people that are willing to do what they did on January 6th. You do not underestimate that.
Yeah.
That's the quickest way to to disaster.
Yeah.
And keep your eyes open. I agree. We should be vigilant.
Google got a lot of grief over the weekend because Google changed their white noise. When you Google white noise,
oh yeah,
and they changed it, and they said it upset children enough that children were having tantrums, so they were getting angry emails from parents. So good news, Google has gone back to their original white noise.
I thought that white noise. Sorry about that.
That's all right.
All right.
This is the original white noise, which not a lot of people know this. This is a recording of WJFK Redskin coverage at the stadium.
Oh, you had your joke ready. Yeah. That's why you jumped in. All right. Okay. I'm sorry. The white noise app was our buddy Todd that did that. Did he have anything to do with this at all?
No.
I think this is free white noise on Google.
Yeah, but Todd's white noise technically is free. He has a free version of it.
Mm-hmm.
Todd's fine. Like this is the health and wellness revolution.
Thank God.
In the last 10 years that has swept the nation. And for me, I saw this article.
Yeah.
I have a Google Home, mm-hmm. and I told Google to play it, and I couldn't tell the difference. If kids can tell, God bless them. But you sit there, you're like, if you want what you want, pay for it.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah,
we get everything for free, and then you bitch about it.
True enough.
I totally agree. You know what makes me sleep like a baby?
What?
And I never realized it, though. Down here... we go to sleep down here where the day is warmed up and things are fine. In the middle of the night, maybe 2-3 in the morning, I will wake up and the house is freezing because we've got a cold snap.
Right
when
on.
I pop on that rare heating down in Southwest Florida, mm-hmm. oh, I could go till noon.
Exactly.
You always think you sleep better when it's cold.
No.
No, I sleep better when you have that warm air coming into the house and you smell that thing kicking on after it hasn't for a long time.
The dust.
Spectacular.
And we've learned from our Sleep Number ads that warm feet will make you fall asleep like 25% faster.
Yeah,
so it's very important. Good.
But I didn't mention this on the show. When your son comes in at 4 o'clock complaining about a sore toe, and it was sore. It was red. It was like he got bitten by something, or it was an infection in a toenail. But he is in pain. I mean, you can tell when they're just meh, and when he's really hurting. So after I got up at 4 o'clock, we had in the marital bed, my son, my dog Winslow, the dog Frankie, and me. And would you like to know how much bed I had? 1/4 inch. All of my massive body frame was hanging off. So I said, might as well just get up, surf the net a little bit, and turn on the heat. And then at 5 o'clock in the morning, I went back into the marital bed. And at that point, they were stirring. So shortly, they were out of there anyway.
Cool.
Life's good. Yeah. Happy day.
Was he in enough pain that he would have laughed if you said that you're going to call a tow truck?
No, he wouldn't have laughed at that, Ron.
Oh, that's sad.
He was hurting.
Oh,
yeah, he
I'm
was hurting. And
that.
He went to the doctor. They actually took him to the doctor, too.
All right.
Let's
close with that. Run it right at his level.
There you go.
Zoom.
Well, it's a Madea joke.
Mike, I think you'll appreciate this as a voice guy. I love this. This is a guy. His name is Bob Bergen. He's done some fill-in work for Mel Blanc for the Warner Brothers cartoons since Mel has died. And he talked about how he got the role of Porky Pig in Space Jam. Now, this is funny because they brought in people that could do Porky's voice but wanted them to improv. So this is him improvising as Porky Pig.
One of the times I had to audition for Porky was for Space Jam, which I did get. For the audition, they had us do Shakespeare.
To be, the opposite.
It's still the greatest.
It is, isn't it?
Porky Pig is still the best Mel Blanc voice.
It is.
Going away. I don't think there's any. The stutter is just spectacular. You play it one more time.
It's almost mathematical the way
you
have
to play.
One of the times I had to audition for Porky was for Space Jam, which I did get. For the audition, they had us do Shakespeare.
To be, the opposite.
Man, can tell why I got the gig. That's good stuff.
Hey, that's all
that.
I got, Mike.
All right, there you go. Let's get out of here, ladies and gentlemen.
Now leaving SoundCloud.
We're leaving, everybody. That's it. All right. Hey, our thanks to Talking Head Robin Ferguson.
Yay.
What a sweet lady. And thank you, Robin, with your wonderful kids and your wonderful husband, Rosie, and the Allenberg Driving School.
Turn
that's
left.
Awesome. Turn right. 200 miles an hour. Wreck the car. You own the car. That's it.
That's
we gotta
their
get
motto.
Out of here.
You wreck it.
Well, you don't want to buy the $6,000 insurance policy, you know? Take the turns gently. We'll be back tomorrow with more fun and more thrills for Rob Spiewak and Oscar Santana. This is Mike O'Mara saying so long, everybody.
Aloha.
Ciao, ciao.
Want more? Make sure you check out the Mike O'Mara Bonus Show. Get it at MikeO'MaraShow.com.
Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
This is a circus.
Hey, save some for Dad now.
I'm a phony, just like you.